HKM-TV presents girls varsity basketball. Tonight, the Hillers take on the Ashland Clockers. Hi, I'm Tim Mladic with Vinny Gotham. And for the third time this season, Hopkinton and Ashland meet on the court, this time in tournament play. And Vinny, Hopkinton is coming into this game with a 15-6 record overall. They've won four of their last five games and are looking to keep that trend going against a tough Clocker team tonight.
Yeah, definitely. They've had a great season today. They've opened up the season above 500. They went on to win the Westboro Invitational. They just had a phenomenal season. I think much of that has to go to Coach Mike Greco. He's really turned this team around, has put a lot of positive energy, and they've just been playing an unbelievable season.
And we're handed over to the public service announcer right now.
And the Ashland Clockers. Participating student athletes, coaches, and contest officials have worked diligently to prepare for today's competition. Please show your appreciation by demonstrating good sportsmanship and respect for all in attendance. Ensure that your behaviors reflect the values that should be identified with these student athletes. Assume responsibility for your behavior and the behavior of those around you. If you require assistance, please call upon an MIAA school or security official. Our great nation has persevered through the leadership and service sacrifices of men and women who have served or are currently serving in our armed forces. We invite both veterans and current military personnel to stand. We thank you for your service to our country. Now, for the starting lineups. For the Ashland Clockers, junior junior guard forward, number 34, Joy Mashashawe.
Oh, you're on the table, yeah.
At forward. Sophomore. Number 44, Ivy Gogolin. At guard, junior, number 11, Julia Canestrari. At guard, junior, co-captain, Emma Lakasha. And at forward, junior, co-captain, number 31, Michaela Pucci. The head coach is Mike Greco, assisted by Kerry Chatton, Kristen Baldiga, and Tim Joyce. The officials for tonight's game, Peter Binney, Tom Giblin, and Stephen Bond. Now, we invite you all to stand for our national anthem.
Well, we are ready to get off to game action after that wonderful rendition of the national anthem sung by the crowd after we had experienced some technical difficulties. And as we get ready to start gameplay, like we were talking about before, Hopkinton has really experienced a revival under new head coach Mike Greco.
Of course. Before he was the girls' head coach, he was coaching Hopkinton boys JV basketball. He had almost a winning percentage, about 70%. He's almost a varsity coach. This is obviously a position that he absolutely loves, and I think he's brought a new type of energy to this team, and they've really been compiled with a group of individuals who work hard and play hard, and they just had an incredible season.
This is the third time that Ashland and Hopkinton meet on the court. Hopkinton won both of those games, the first one by a score of 52-48, the second one a little more lopsided. The Hillers took that one 54-40. And there will be another jump ball after that one went out of bounds. Referee cannot get a clear look at who touched it, so they just decided to do it over.
Yeah, that was a little bit of a mix-up between Ivy Gogolin and Megan Russell, so we'll have a redo of the jump ball.
Ball is up, and Hopkinton controls it.
Ashland is coming out with a 2-3 zone so far. Let's see how it works against the Hopkinton girls.
Lacascio looking for help, and she took a step and is hit with the travel.
Yeah, that happens. Sometimes you just get the missed foot, and then it was a good call by the ref.
Perhaps working out some early nerves to start this game. Big crowd here to watch them play.
Oh, yeah, definitely. The crowd here is great. And I think the Hopkinton girls really feed off the crowd's energy. So if they can get the crowd going early, I think that'll work to their advantage. But as you can see, there's a huge Ashland crowd here, too. So
absolutely. Just a slight stoppage in play. Referees discussing something.
I think one of those shot clocks over there has been shut off. So some really bad technical difficulties.
Yeah,
before
we were having
start.
A little bit of trouble today. Couldn't get through the public service announcements. The national anthem didn't work. And now we have a broken shot clock.
I think everybody's nervous so far. Not just the players.
I guess so. Oh, looks like it has been restored.
All right.
And we are about to get back to the game.
Hopkinton's pressing so far. Let's see how it works against the Ashland girls. They're opening up against man, but I would expect that their defense to change. Greco likes to go to a lot of zone coverage, a lot of 1-1-3, a lot of diamond.
Thurber wide open, launches a three.
That was
off
good
the rim and rebounded by Hopkinton.
Good shot, just didn't get her feet squared.
Nice pass from Emma Lacascia, finds Pucci. Pucci cannot finish, but will be taking two from the free throw line. Nice play from Lacascia to find the cutting Pucci.
Yeah, Pucci's really good down the post. I would expect her to have a big game.
First shot is good for Pucci.
It's a very peculiar routine that she has, but Greco likes to stress a lot that whatever you routine that you have during the free throw line, use that every single time, and then it just becomes second nature or some type of muscle memory.
Well, obviously, the message has gotten through. Pucci knocks down both.
The girls are pressing again.
Nice pass inside to Missouri. She can't get it. Meswoswe grabs the miss and puts it in for Ashland. 2-2.
That was a really good rebound by her. Hiller's got to do a little bit more defense right now. They look a little sloppy on defense.
Lacascia turns down the open three. And it's stolen away by Samantha Leone. She drives, takes the jump shot. It is fouled. Cannot convert, but will be shooting two from the line.
Yeah, I don't think that was a very good foul. So let's see. Two shots for the free throw. I believe that's Sam Leone at the free throw line.
And her first free throw is off the front of the rim. Second one.
Yeah, the Hillers got lucky there.
As well. Now the Hillers are going to look to get something going offensively.
The Clockers are still showing the 2-3 zone. So far, I think they've had some success with it. So let's see if they stick with the 2-3 zone or they can resort to something else.
And a bit too aggressive there was Megan Russell, the senior.
Yeah, whenever you're reaching like that and grab a player's hand, the ref is always going to call that play.
Canestrari with a nice idea trying to get it into Goglin. Ashland knocks it out of bounds. Hillers retain possession and will inbound under the Clocker hoop.
Yeah, Iva's had a great season. I think it's going to be really important for her to get some action early on so she can settle down and have a great game because she's a huge part of this Hillers offense.
Pucci throws up the awkward shot and nails it. 4-2, yeah, lead for Hopkinton.
That looked like a very circus shot, but Pucci's really good down low, so she's been working on that craft, and she's really perfected it this year.
Thurber launches a three off the top of the backboard, out of bounds. Hopkinton takes over.
Yeah, she had a good look, just wasn't able to convert.
Ashland pressing as well. Both teams looking to cause some early turnovers, capitalize on the nerves.
Mm-hmm. Ooh, a little screw up there.
And right there was a turnover. Looks like an inadvertent whistle because it was not a backcourt violation because a Hopkinton player did not call it, or did not touch it, excuse me.
So the Clockers have the ball right under their hoop. Nice pass.
Pass inside to Miss Wosley. Ball rattles around. It drops down.
That was a beautiful read. Find the open player down low in the post and give it to her and shoot the easy two-pointer.
4-4 tie with 5.5 minutes left in the first quarter.
If I were the Hillers, I would get it down low. Get Canestrari and Ivy Goglin into some action.
Great play from Canestrari. She knew Megan Russell was looking for an outlet and jumped right in front of the pass, made Russell throw it higher than she wanted, and results in a turnover.
Yeah, this press has really been working for the Hillers. I would see that they would go with this press for a while until it stops working.
And Hopkinton turns it right over into the hands of Megan Russell. She drives, throws up the shot, and is fouled. Another trip to the free throw line for Ashland.
Yeah, the Hillers are looking pretty sloppy on defense so far. It must just be a result of pregame jitters, first playoff game, so let's see if they can settle down a little bit, play to their strengths, and let's see if they can get a few easy points off the Clockers' D.
Nothing but net for Russell on the first. Short on the second, and Pucci grabs the board. Pass inside to Goglin, tries to throw up this tough shot, has it blocked, and Leone comes up with a loose ball for Ashland.
Yeah, that was a great block by Leone. Way to get up there.
Leone gets a pick, puts up the jump shot, banks it off the glass, and in.
Yeah, that was a great screen set up by Ashland, and she was able to get a good bank shot off, and now the Hillers are looking like they're down 3 points. Good
Morningstar
pass.
Morningstar looking for help. She finds it. Canestrari drives, throws up the hook, bit short. And Leone just wrestles the ball away from the smaller Morningstar. Finds Russell, and one from Meg Russell. Wow. Great play from Samantha Leone to grab the ball from Lily Morningstar, not commit the foul, and then book it down to the other end and find her teammate for the open layup.
Yeah, in Hillers basketball, that would be called bread and butter. Getting that done. Greco loves doing bread and butter. He thinks that his defense should play really well, and that turns into their offense.
And Coach Greco just called a timeout. Perhaps wanting to talk about that bread and butter that Ashland just used on them.
It's a very effective method.
And while we have some time, the MIAA would like you to know that a well-rounded education is one that is not only academically oriented, but one that also includes physical, social, and emotional development. Interscholastic athletics provide the other half of education. The MIAA encourages you to support your local high school athletic teams throughout the school year.
I would expect that Coach Greco would try and change up some defense. They've been really sloppy so far, so I wouldn't be surprised at all if they switch up the defense, give the Clockers something new, and try to get them off balance and try to get some turnovers early in the game.
Like we've mentioned before, though, it seems, again, some uncharacteristic play, I think, from both teams. I've seen Ashland a few times this year, and Hopkinton,
yeah,
obviously,
absolutely,
more than a few times. But I just watched the Medway game a few days ago, and there both teams had pregame or early game jitters. It took them more than a quarter to figure things out and finally get going. And I kind of feel like that's happening in this game as well. Some uncharacteristic plays from both teams, passes that are to no one, just some early game jitters that they have to work out.
Yeah, it happens to everyone, even to the pros. So let's see if they can settle down a little bit.
Some quick passing from Hopkinton. Eventually, ball gets into Gogolin, and she misses the shot, and it's grabbed by Ashland.
Yeah, Gogolin had a good shot, but the Ashland D has been playing really well so far. So let's see if they can keep it up.
Tough pass inside. Somehow finds its way into the hands of Samantha Leone. She can't finish.
Good
now
rebound
Pucci
by Pucci. Nice pass.
Keaveney launches a three. Rattles out.
Yeah, that's always a tough shot.
Ashland maintaining a 10-4 lead with 3.5 minutes left in the first quarter.
Hopkinton has had success with Ashland before this season. They won both games, so I would say that they should probably use the same game plan that they used to win those two games and see if they can convert.
Thurber launches another three, short. Missouri grabs the board, tries to finish, cannot. And Gogolin puts a little too much strength into that bounce pass, and it ends up going over the head of Corby.
Yeah, that was almost 5.5 feet above the ground. Big, really hard pass. Quite a few turnovers committed by Hopkinton so far. Let's see if they can try and settle down a little bit.
Hopkinton in man-to-man defense right now. Ball gets inside to Meswosui, and a 3-second violation called. Turnover for the Clockers.
Yeah, I don't think she was aware of that, so 3-second violation was called by the ref. Again, the Clockers are showing some press.
And turning that press back into zone defense. Morningstar with a nice pass to Gogolin. Gogolin draws the foul and converts and one for the sophomore.
Yeah, she's been really playing well this season. I would suggest that they get it to her, their low players, Canestrari, Pucci, Gogolin, get some easy basket because they're such great athletes and they can really move around down in the post and they're very comfortable when they're there. So my game plan for Greco would probably be to get them down in the post, try and get them a good few shots and good looks, and as you can see right here, shoot a couple three throws.
And Gogolin converts the old-fashioned three-pointer, making this a 10-7 game in favor of Ashland.
The Hillers still using that press. Let's see if it's still working. They've had some success with it, so I would suggest they keep on rolling with the press down low.
And a foul called on Regan Keaveney. A bit too aggressive coming off that screen.
Yeah, that
trying to get through it.
That was a pretty easy call for the ref every time you reach in like that. Easy call.
Leone drives, throws up the shot just short, and wrestling for the board is Keaveney.
Morningstar's taking it up.
Again, like you said, the plan looks to be to get Ivy Gogolin the ball down low, but a turnover there, and Megan Russell takes it all the way.
That was a beautiful crossover right there. Really smooth, nice.
Great ball movement from the Hillers. Carlson from three, no good. Gogolin crashes the offensive glass. She cannot finish either. And now Leone grabs it and is on the run.
Yeah, just keep on giving Ivy the ball. She'll score soon, don't worry. Nice defensive play.
With the great deed, knocks the ball out of bounds. Still Ashland ball. Canestrari and Pucci sub back in.
Hiller's still playing man to man. Good
and
turn.
Keaveney seals it away and is tied up by Russell. A jump ball, and this one goes to Ashland.
Wow, as you can see, Mr. Greco doesn't look too happy about that.
Leone drives and is wrapped up by Carlson, and this one is called a foul.
Yeah, that honestly looked like a travel to me. I didn't see too much contact down low, but I think the refs must have seen something. Greco's trying to give an explanation to him.
Leone will shoot two. And the first one trickles in. 13-7 lead for Ashland with just over a minute left in the first quarter.
Yeah, Leone's been playing a pretty good game. She's got to the free throw line, hit a couple shots. She's having a pretty good game so far.
And 2-2 on that trip for the senior, Leone. Canestrari launches a three.
It's a good shot. Just
misses and then bounces off the foot of Meswoswe. Hopkinton lucky to keep the ball there.
Gogolin is subbing back in for Morningstar.
Keaveney trying to find someone to avoid the 5-second call. She does. Canestrari gets it, drives, throws up the shot. Nothing can fall for the Hillers right now. Pucci thought she had the offensive board, but Mazurek was able to wrestle it away from her, and then Pucci's hit with the reach-in.
Yeah, a couple of Hillers getting into some, not foul trouble, but some early fouls, not looking too good.
Courtney Thurber subs back in for Ashland. Meg Russell gets a rest.
Hiller still using the press.
Leone looking for help, gets it. Thurber launches a three, but is rejected by Canestrari.
That was a great block by Canestrari. Way to get her there and just swat it away.
Leone will inbound for Ashland. And a travel is called on Ashland. Another turnover for the Clockers.
Yeah, I think her foot just misstepped, and I think she knew it right away when the ref called it.
Shot clock is off. Hopkinton has the opportunity to take the last shot of the quarter if they so choose. Down 7.
Yeah, I would take my time.
Canestrari.
Nice shot.
Launches the shot. 5 seconds left, knocks it down. Now Leone notices the clock is low, looks to beat it, fires up the shot and knocks it down. Sam Leone having a great opening quarter. As Vinny said, able to knock down some free throws and that acrobatic last second shot to make this a 16-9 lead for Ashland.
Yeah, if I were the Hillers, I would try and put someone on Leone at all times right now. She's really looking good this first quarter. Try and limit her as much as possible. And let's see if some of the other Ashland players can show up big. But for the Hillers, they just need to improve their defense right now. They're allowing a lot of easy shots, especially in the post. Ashland's getting a lot of their boards. And
right, like you said, Hopkinton struggling a bit, both offensively and defensively. only able to muster up 9 points in that opening quarter. One of their season lows, I'm sure. And like you said, Coach Greco definitely trying to drive the point home that, you know, probably the worst is over. The first quarter, a lot of those jitters out, a few of those uncharacteristic turnovers that we saw and we're talking about, got those out of the system. And all things considered, only down 7 points after that first quarter.
Yeah, if I were the Hillers, I want to get this crowd in. We have a huge showing tonight. If they can get the crowd in, that will definitely work to their advantage. So far, the Ashland crowd has been looking really energetic, really giving them a lot of good reps and giving them a lot of good energy to get out there and start playing hard. So I think if they can get this Hopkinton crowd in, it'll work to their advantage.
I was going to say, this was supposed to be a home game for Hopkinton, wasn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, it looks like half like, and half.
Yeah, they got a strong presence here. Absolutely.
Well, this is one of the greatest rivalries in Massachusetts, most probably Hopkinton Ashland. This rivalry's been around for over 100 years.
And Hopkinton starts the second quarter with the ball. Pass inside to Gogol and slips through her hands. Pucci able to recover and grab it, and she's fouled and will shoot free throws.
Yeah, that was a good play by Pucci. Good pump fake and then was able to draw the foul, and now she'll shoot a couple.
First shot no good for Pucci. And she knocks down one of two on that trip. 16-10 lead for Ashland. Again, like you said, echoing your points earlier, they have Lily Morningstar, the freshman defensive stalwart, on Samantha Leone, apparently giving them too much trouble.
Yeah, Morningstar's been playing. She's only a freshman, but she's had a great season this year. She's not much of a scorer, but she's a really good playmaker. She can get the ball down.
Canestari launches the three. Almost getting in there was Morningstar. And then kind of a ticky-tack foul called on Pucci right there.
Yeah, that was a little bit of an awkward foul. It happens, though.
Yeah, referee kind of had to call that one. She didn't really hit her that hard, but the contact caused her to fall over. So referees left no choice but to call a foul. And now Ashland is in the bonus, shooting 1-1. Not a good sign for Hopkinton to be fouling this much this early.
Yeah, at least Carlson has checked in now for Pucci.
And Russell knocks down the first. She will get another one. Second one rolls out, and now Hopkinton's on the break. Carlson, nothing called there. Looks like it had to be something, but the referees decide to let it go, and now Carlson misses the layup.
Yeah, that was not a good shot. She just kind of just threw up a scoop shot, not hoping to draw a foul.
Mazurek gets it down low, uses her body, and throws it off the glass.
Yeah, Mazurek was no match compared for Emma LaCascia, using that body up to get an easy two-pointer.
Carlson fakes a three, takes a step in and launches. Short on the shot, Morningstar there to grab the loose ball. Canestari gets blocked by Mazurek. Great play from Ashland's defense.
Yeah,
now Leone
really
is driving, almost converts. Ball just rolls out. LaCascia with a great pass from Carlson. Passes it to Canestari for a fast break layup for Hopkinton. Timeout, Ashland.
Yeah, there's that bread and butter that I was talking about, using that to get up to the board. Yeah, I think that's going to be important for Hopkinton. Make your defense turn into your offense. Focus on defense, trying to get some turnovers and get those into easy points.
Again, while we have a timeout, the MIAA would like you to know that more than 200,000 students will participate in approximately 100,000 high school sport competitions among the MIAA's 360 member schools this year. The Massachusetts Interscholastic Athletic Association encourages you to support your local high school athletic programs and the students who participate in them. That actually brings me to this point. We are in the Division II MIAA tournament section, the central section, and actually the TVL was well represented in this tournament. Like I said earlier, Medway, the Mustangs played, they made it. Hopkinton and Ashland, obviously both in the TVL, they made it. And Medfield, actually Medway will play Medfield on Friday. So the TVL having a strong representation in postseason play.
Yeah, of course. They've really looked good this season. All the games that I watched, the girls, they've always been tough matchups, always going down to the wire. So this year was definitely a great season for Hopkinton and the TVL in general.
And there's Leone again knocking down the jumper. She has been definitely a major spark for Ashland and is a huge part of this 21-12 lead early in the second quarter.
Again, I would try and get a person on her at all times, even trying to double team her at times, trying to get her uncomfortable, not getting these easy shots that she's been able to get so far.
Meanwhile, on the defensive end, Taylor Mazurek able to do a great job of standing still, throwing her arms straight up and not drawing or not being hit with a lot of fouls.
Yeah, she's really doing well in the post. I think Ivy Gogolin has to kind of assert her dominance like she has a lot through the season.
And a loose ball last off Meg Russell, turnover for Ashland, as Callie Corby subs back in the game for Hopkinton. Canestrari almost loses that one. Crowd calling for a travel. Somehow saves that. Great play by Canestrari to keep that play alive for Hopkinton.
Yeah, definitely. She was getting double teamed. She was able to kick it back out to Corby.
And a turnover. Morningstar fires it right at the face of Kiara Flynn. Flynn able to grab it for Ashland.
Nice shot.
Russell pulls up, launches the jumper. No good. Rebounded by Hopkinton.
The Clockers have gone away from their press a little bit. They're not pressing Hopkinton as much as they were in the first quarter.
Hopkinton still looking on how to figure out this 2-3 zone of Ashland. Another missed shot from Gogolin.
Beautiful pass.
Flynn with the great pass to a cutting Meg Russell. And another timeout called by Coach Greco. And Ashland has now opened up an 11-point lead.
Yeah, Coach Greco can't be too happy about that. Again, they need to focus on their defense right now. Their defense has been pretty sloppy. Offense, they've been pretty good. Whenever they get good fast break points, they're able to convert, but they need to get some improvements done on their defense if they want to win this game.
Again, the score 23-12. Ashland has really turned on the offensive and defensive pressure, being able to get most of what they want from guard Samantha Leone down on the offensive end. And then defensively, Taylor Mazurek has been a force down in the paint, not letting Ivy Gogolin or Pucci, who will normally dominate the offensive glass, she is not letting them do that. And when anyone comes in there and tries to take a shot, she is there to help them change their mind a little bit.
Yeah, definitely. It looks like the Clockers came in with a big game plan to stop their two post players, Gogolin and Canestrari and Michaela Pucci. So far it's worked. So let's see if some other Hopkinton player can step up and really get the Hillers through.
And after the timeout, Hopkinton will inbound, and Ashland setting up that press, the two-player press, kind of a laid-back press. They try to see if they can force a cheap turnover, and then they back off once Hopkinton gets close to the half-court line, but it has forced turnovers already.
Yeah, they're still resorting to the 2-3 zone. So far, Hopkinton, I don't think, has been able to figure out this defense yet.
It looked like a travel there on Corby, not called. 6 seconds left on the shot clock, and pass thrown away. Leone comes up with it. Pass inside to Mazurek.
Nice block.
Takes the contact. Block called and by Gogolin, and she finds Corby. Gogolin wanted it back. You can tell. Canestrari fires a three. No good. Gogolin grabs the offensive board and draws the foul. She will be shooting too.
Yeah, that was a good play by Ivy Gogolin doing a little pump fake and then hitting the floor hard and getting the two free throws.
You could tell she wanted the ball back right on the fast break. She was throwing her hands up. She didn't get it originally and then got it back and made it worth her while by drawing the foul. Misses the first free throw, however. Still 23-12 Ashland.
Yeah, free throws can play a big game, big part in this game right now. You got to convert.
Especially with all the fouls we've been seeing in this game. Yeah. Gogolin, a great play, anticipated the miss and was able to jump in and force a jump ball.
Seems like she wanted that play, those two missed free throws back.
Yeah, she did. Ashland receives this one, but still a great play nonetheless by Gogolin as she gets subbed out for Michaela Pucci. Now it looks like Hopkinton is in a full-blown press right now.
Yeah, that makes sense right now. They're down 11 points. They got to get some defense going so far. So hopefully this press can get the ball rolling for the Hillers.
Ashland goes right through, able to get a decent shot down low. And the ball rolls out of bounds off of Canestrari. Ashland will have an opportunity to score on this possession. It's supposed to be left open for the jumper. Bit too strong, and Pucci's able to grab the board.
Yeah, she didn't square her feet on that shot. Oh, beautiful pass.
Canestrari able to put herself in front of the hoop, grabs the pass, nice pump fake, and then throws up a shot, and she is fouled.
Yeah, that was a beautiful pass by Emma Lacoste, getting up to find.
First one good for Canestrari, and Gogolin, after getting a quick substitution, comes back in. Getting a quick rest, excuse me, subs back in for Regan Keaveney.
So now Hopkins has their big three players down low in the post now, so I would expect them to go hit either Canestrari, Ivy Gogolin, or Emma Lacoste down low.
Two for two on that trip from the free throw line. 23-14 lead for Ashland. 3 minutes left in the first half. Flynn with a nice pass inside to Leone. She was unable to handle it. However, Hopkinton comes up with it. Ashland comes up with it. Russell misses the close range shot. Ball goes out of bounds, and Hopkinton lucky not let up any points there.
Yeah, that was a pretty good defensive possession by Hopkinton. That really worked. They were in each of the Ashland Clockers' faces. They were not giving them easy shots.
Canestrari almost loses it. Able to recover. Morningstar stripped. Ball's loose.
Great
hustle. Morningstar
hustle.
Dives to the floor to grab it and intelligently throws it off of an Ashland player's leg. And the ball goes out of bounds, so Hopkinton able to keep possession there. Great hustle play from Morningstar.
Absolutely.
Gogolin got the ball inside, tried to fire it back to Morningstar, ended up throwing it right in the hands of Meg Russell, and another turnover for Hopkinton.
Yeah, Hopkinton's got to eliminate all these turnovers that they're committing so far. That's really what's been killing them so far in this game. They can limit the turnovers, I think they'll be in good shape.
Because even with all these turnovers, still only down 9, game's still well within striking distance. Leone fires up a shot, gets her own rebound, takes a few steps back, launches again, misses, almost grabbed a second offensive rebound. Canestrari fires a three, knocks it down. Exactly what Hopkinton needs right now. A big three from Canestrari.
Yeah, she really loves shooting that three ball. Not only can she play down post, but really, she's a good sharp shooter right now.
23-17 in favor of the Clockers. Kiara Flynn threw up a circus shot layup. Ends up in the hands of Hopkinton. Canestrari launches again, bit too strong. And Flynn grabs the board for Ashland.
Yeah, as long as the Hillers can keep it close, I think they'll be fine. Only
Thurber launches a quick three off the front of the rim, but Meg Russell is there to clean it up.
Good offensive rebound by Meg Russell right there.
Morningstar kind of threw it away and lost it. And then in the following scrum, a jump ball is called.
Kate Wazell, the senior of Hopkins and Hillers, has checked in.
As well as Isabella Getman for the Clockers. 41 seconds left in the half. Canestrari left open for three, knocks it down. Julia Canestrari, 6 quick points for Hopkinton, bringing this game within 5.
Yeah, she's got the hot hand right now. I would want to get the ball to Canestrari anytime I can.
Leone drives, is tripped, nothing called, rebound, Hopkinton.
Shot clock shut off now.
20 seconds left for the Hillers to get a shot. And the refs stop play temporarily, discussing something.
Wonder if he saw a travel maybe, or.
And I don't know what happened, but I do know that is the second time the referees have inadvertently blown the whistle.
Yeah, Greco doesn't seem too happy about that. Hopkinton had a good possession right there and was stopped short.
10 seconds left for Hopkinton to get a shot off. Again, like Vinny said, shot clock is off. Nice pass, and Canestrari open for three. No good. And Ashland grabs the board. So after the end of the first half, Ashland takes a 5-point lead into the break, up 25-20.
Yeah, Canestrari really pulled through this second quarter. Now the Hillers are only down 5 after halftime. They have to be pretty happy about themselves.
I'm sure Coach Greco will be telling his team to settle things down to start this second half so they can get back, maybe take the lead in the third quarter.
Yeah, definitely. Since it's a playoff game, obviously they're going to be pregame jitters. Every team goes through that.
But right.
I think they did settle down, especially late in that second quarter, moving the ball around quickly, getting some bread and butter options, trying to get a few turnovers from Ashland. So I think they'll be all right, as long as they keep it close. As long as it's anywhere lower than 10 points, I think they should be able to okay, and then eventually they should probably want to pull through late in the fourth quarter.
All right, we will see after the halftime break if Coach Greco and the Hiller girls can come back and take this game away from Ashland. We'll be back after the break. And we are back, getting ready to start the second half. Ashland has a 5-point lead, up 25-20. And Vinny, this game we saw early, both teams had a little of the early game jitters. Some uncharacteristic turnovers and just some otherwise weird plays that you wouldn't normally see from these two talented teams. What do you think we're going to see here to start the third quarter?
Well, for Hopkinton, I would look to see that Julia Canestrari gets the ball. She's had the hot hand, especially. She hit 2 clutch 3-pointers late in the second quarter. For them, I would think get the ball down in the post, especially for Julia Canestrari. For Ashland, they did pretty good job of containing Hopkinton defensive-wise, so I would stick to the 2-3 zone for Ashland, and I would try and limit Julia Canestrari from getting the ball. Offensively, getting Leone to get the ball, shooting a couple threes, getting her into the low post, I think that's a good game plan for them.
All right, we'll see what happens here as Ashland starts the second half with the ball up 5 in the hands of their star, senior guard Leone. And Hopkinton, again in man-to-man, have stayed with that for the majority of this game. And again, a shot clock issue. And it's restored almost immediately. Oh, and then goes off again.
Yeah, some technical issues this game.
Yeah, to say the least. We've had national anthem issues, microphone issues, and shot clock issues.
Yeah, not their best night.
Like you said, everyone's nervous, I guess.
Yeah, definitely. And this is Hopkins and Ashland, one of the best rivalries in all of Massachusetts. So always, the hype is always on when these games are being played.
And it looks like power is restored to the other shot clock, and we'll get back to the game. 11 seconds left for Ashland to get shot off. Leone with it, steps up, nice block from Gogolin. Clean block, Morningstar takes it the whole way, throws it up. Gogolin there to finish, clean up the miss.
Yeah, that's what I was talking about, using your defense and converting that into offense. That is basic Hopkinton basketball fundamentals right there.
And another whistle.
The Ashland faithful giving it really to this ref right now.
Referees again discussing something. And now Ashland will inbound. Finally get the ball to Missouri. Great bounce pass to Maswoswe, but Maswoswe is rejected by Canestrari. And Mapucci takes it down the other end, can't finish, gets it back, and draws the foul. She'll be shooting too.
Yeah, Pucci's really doing well down post, and she's been able to get to the free throw line using her body, doing a few pump fakes, and able to draw the foul against quite a few Ashland players.
A great block on the other end by Canestrari, which spurred this trip to the free throw line for Pucci while she knocks down the first.
Now the Hillers are only down two. Now it's a ball game right here.
And Pucci knocks down both. A one-point game.
Again, the Hillers showing some press, but not that aggressive. They're trying to get maybe a turnover here and there.
Morningstar still on Leone. And Lakashia hit with the blocking foul. And Callie Corby subs in for Akasha, who was just hit with that foul. And the ball finds its way into the hands of Leone. Good pass inside to Maswosu. She pivots and puts it off the glass and in. Great pass from Mazurek.
Yeah, that was a really good play by Maswosu right there, using her body and going in and twisting and being able to kiss it off the glass and getting it in.
Morningstar drives. Looks like she took an extra step. Not called, but 2 points for Hopkinton.
Again, now it's a one-point game.
And Morningstar has her hands full on the defensive end, again guarding Leone as Mazurek knocks down the deep two.
Yeah, Mazurek has also been playing a really good game. We've been talking a lot about Leone, but Mazurek definitely showing a good defensive presence and also at the offensive side as well.
Meanwhile, Canestrari hit with the travel. Another turnover for Hopkinton. Great pass from Leone to a cutting Maswosu. Nothing called. And then fighting is Hopkinton and Ashley, and a jump ball is called. That was an absolutely terrific pass from Leone. However, Maswosu wasn't able to finish, rejected.
Yeah, Canestrari was able to get her hands up and was able to block the shot off.
And then a quick turnover, Meg Russell comes up with it. And Pucci fighting for that defensive rebound. And a quick jump ball called. Looks like the referees are avoiding calling a foul on anyone in that particular situation and instead are just quick to give it a jump ball.
Yeah, and also the Hillers have been turning the ball over. We saw that a lot in the first half, so let's hope that doesn't carry through the second half.
Leone fires a three. No good. Gogolin with a great box out of Mazurek, able to grab that rebound. And Pucci bringing it down the whole way. contact, but nothing called. Now Leone with it. She drives, great spin move from Leone, able to somehow finagle that ball in.
Yeah, the Ashland girls really got this crowd into it. They've really been feeding off their energy so far.
Canestrari fouled on the drive. That was on the floor before she attempted the shot. So Hopkinton will inbound under the Ashland hoop. Now I should mention that the winner of this game will play the winner of a game tomorrow between Notre Dame and Marlboro. And that game will take place on March 9th at 7:30. So if Hopkinton is able to win this game here tonight, they will be playing on March 9th at 7:30, either against Notre Dame or Marlboro.
Yeah, that would be a great game either way, most likely.
10 seconds left on the shot clock. Hopkinton struggling offensively right now. Canestrari pulls up, no good. Able to grab the board is Gogolin, and she cleans it up again, working the offensive glass, finally able to get something going for Hopkinton.
Yeah, she had a bit of a quiet first half, so I'm sure Mr. Greco would like to get Ivy into the game action because she's been such a crucial part for this team this whole season.
Canestrari, ball bounces off her head. Keaveney comes up with it. Canestrari comes up with the loose ball, throws up a shot. Kind of a poor decision there, but bailed out with the foul. And they also missed a double dribble on Keaveney a few seconds earlier. Ashland fans not very happy right now. Canestrari doesn't care what the fans think. She knocks down the first free throw.
Yeah, Canestrari really showing up for the Hillers girls. She's been the star player so far, so I will look to get Canestrari the ball anytime I can, especially if she's open down low. And she can also shoot the three ball really well. She hit quite a few two threes in the late second quarter.
And while we have a timeout, a PSA from MIAA. The Massachusetts Interscholastic Athletic Association annually sanctions the Sportsmanship Award to students, adults, and schools for exemplary behavior. The intent is to enhance the educational ideals sought by the MIAA and to encourage sportsmanship as a major objective in their experience as a participant. This is just another example of activities enhancing student development in a unique and motivating laboratory for learning. Your support and encouragement of these important ideals is appreciated. Well, as we come back from the timeout, Ashland has a 31-29 lead with 4 minutes left in the third quarter. And Canestrari will be shooting her second free throw. And she knocks it down, a one-point game. Finally getting some scoring going here in the third quarter.
Absolutely.
Took us a half to get here, but we finally got here. Russell drives, throws up the layup, high off the glass, cannot finish. Meswoswi grabs it. She throws up a shot of her own and is fouled. Meswoswi working the offensive glass. Both teams able to really exert their will on the offensive glass. Both close to double-digit offensive rebounds.
Yeah, both teams really have good post players. So I think that's been the game plan most of the game here for both Ashland and Hopkinton, getting it to their post players and making them get the plays that they need.
Mazurek, she's not on the court now, but she has been an absolute force during this game, as well as Ivy Goglin able to work on the offensive boards as well. Meanwhile, running full court was Morningstar. She throws up a shot, missed, and somehow the ball tipped right back into the hoop. Now we have a tie game.
A little bit more of that
Canestrari
bread butter.
Canestrari reads the pass, steals it, takes it the whole way, and travels.
Yeah, it looked like she misplanted one of her foot, and then the ref was able to see it and called the travel.
She got stuck and tried to spin, ultimately hit with the travel, and now Ashland is in possession.
Tie game though, Tim.
Yes, it is, with 3.5 minutes left in the third quarter as that ball is thrown out of bounds. Ashland ball. Loose ball taken away by Keaveney, and then Russell sees it right back, able to find her teammate for the layup, no good, and somehow Ashley ends up with the ball again. And Leone calming things down, wants to get a good shot. She finds Flynn, baseline jumper, a bit too strong. Now Keaveney comes up with it. She takes it the whole way, and a blocking foul on Ashley, and two shots coming up for Keaveney.
Yeah, the Clockers have been looking a little sloppy right now on both sides of the defense and on the offense. The offense, their shots aren't falling. They're not getting really good shots. But credit to the Hillers' defense. They've really stepped up from the first quarter and the second quarter, and they really pulled through.
Michaela Pucci subbing back in, giving Canestari a well-deserved rest. She's been active offensively and defensively, knocking down threes and causing steals for this Hillers team. And Keaveney knocks down the second, the first lead for Hockington in this game. Morningstar again working on Leone, almost takes that ball right away from her.
The freshman sensation lives on.
Russell drives, throws up the shot, too strong. Gogolin had not reestablished herself in bounds before she grabbed that ball. So a turnover there. And a timeout called by Ashland. So with 2:43 left in the third quarter, Hockington takes their first lead of the game.
Yeah, this is really a pivotal point for Hockington. Now let's see if they can still add on to this lead. And honestly, their defense has been shaping up to be really good this second half. I really like what I've been seeing with them. They're really doing well down low, not getting, being able to handle Leone and Mazurek, who've been really Ashland's key players. So I would continue trying to contain those two and not give Ashland easy points. First quarter and second quarter, you're able to see Ashland get a lot of easy points on fast breaks. So they've really limited that, which I really like from the Hillers.
There we see the Hopkinton boys, who have also made the tournament this year, able to win their last game to get that 10th win. Up to 500 and able to make the postseason as well.
Yeah, they'll be playing Medfield. They'll be at Medfield tomorrow at 7:00, so that'll be definitely a game to watch.
So a successful year on the whole, I'd say, for Hopkinton basketball, both teams making postseason play.
Definitely.
Let's see if these Hiller girls can make it past the quarterfinals here against Ashland. Up one with 2.5 minutes left in the third quarter. Russell fires it into Meswoswe. Nothing doing there. Kicks it back to Leone. She fires a three. Nothing but net for the senior guard. A big shot there from Leone. Open from three. Keaveney getting a piece of that was Leone. A great play defensively. Gogolin does a great job as well getting her hands on that pass. Tried to find a teammate, ended up passing it right through a few people's legs.
Yeah, that pass was a little bit too hard. Hit the ground hard and was able to bounce really high, so that's why it went out of bounds.
In any event, ends up in Ashland's hands, up two. Now Leone will look to get things going for the Clockers. And a few violations there missed on Leone. Coming up with the block is Gogolin. Now Morningstar takes the shot. A lot of contact, nothing called.
Yeah, those were two possessions. There were one on the defensive side where they were looking for a charge, didn't get it, and then another one where Morningstar was driving but just wasn't able to get the call. And the Hiller faithful really giving it to these refs right now.
Coach Greco clearly not pleased. Swosui drives, throws up a layup, cannot hit it. Now Corby has it for the Hillers. Canestrari open, fires a three off the front rim. Morningstar tried to get in there to save it. Unable to, throws it out, and Ashland will take over.
Yeah, Mazurek hasn't been getting a lot of action. She was really good on the defensive glass, so she's been on the bench for a while now, so I would expect the Ashland coach to try and get Mazurek back in the game, try and see her defensive presence on the court.
Leone drives, kicks it over. Nesuosu thought about the shot, passes it over for a three instead. Getman, no good. Now Pucci with it. Gogolin running down the lane. Good idea from Pucci, put a little too much on that pass. Gogolin unable to handle it, and it results in a turnover.
Yeah, again, using that same bread and butter, trying to get their defense to play well and converting that into easy points on their offense.
Gogolin takes a seat as well as Morningstar. Kate Wellzell and Keaveney sub back into the game.
The Hillers again showing their press.
Half a minute left in the third quarter. Ashland still up two, 35-33. And a double dribble called on Kiara Flynn. Turnover for the Clockers.
Yeah, and you have to wonder, when will Missouri get back in the game? I think Ashland's really been missing her.
Shot clock off. Hopkinton had the opportunity to score there, and Canestrari hit with a travel.
So I believe that the Clocker should get the last shot of the third quarter then.
That's right, shot clock is off. Leone checking to make sure. She's got 12 seconds left to make something happen. Gives it up, but gets it right back. Doing it all on her own, throws up a tough shot. Cannot get it. Canestrari did not know how much time was left and tried to throw a pass to Kate Wellzell, streaking toward the hoop. Ball goes out of bounds in any event. That is the end of the third quarter with Ashland maintaining a two-point lead.
Yeah, definitely. The Hillers have definitely come back from the second quarter. They've been playing great D, and they've been getting good fast break points this third quarter, which has resulted in quite a few of their points that they've scored. So let's see if that can transition over to the fourth quarter.
Again, while we have another break, the MIAA would like you to know that high school sports provide an extension of the classroom, where students learn to pursue excellence, the value of working with others toward a common goal, playing within the structure of established rules, discipline, loyalty, and emotional control. The MIAA urges you to demonstrate your support for these values and for our young people by attending high school competitions in your community. Well, we know how the fans feel about that last statement. They have been making their grievances well known here tonight. And honestly, I gotta say, I agree with the fans in this case. We've seen a couple of missed calls, inadvertent whistles from these referees. And then it's kind of mostly what you want when you're playing as a player and a coach is consistency. And I don't really think we've seen that here tonight.
Yeah, and especially the coaches, Mike Greco and the Ashland head coach, they've also not enjoyed some of the calls that the refs have made. So overall, it happens though. It's basketball.
Right.
You miss some calls, you get some calls.
Right. If one person's happy, then you're not doing your job right.
Yeah.
So we start the fourth quarter here. Hopkinton with the ball, pass inside to Gogolin and tipped out of bounds.
Yeah, they had the right idea. Just Mazurek's back in the game, so let's see how her defensive presence will be able to transition onto the court, and let's see how Hopkinton responds.
I'm sure they will find that lane is a lot more clogged up with Mazurk's presence there. Nice pass inside Gogolin, able to take the contact and one, Michaela Pucci.
She just looks so comfortable when she's in the post. She's so smooth with the shot. Honestly, she's been a great asset for this team, this Hiller team. And she's had an okay game tonight, but let's see if they can get some more action into her in the fourth quarter.
And Pucci, only 5'9", really works hard and is very feisty underneath the rim, able to grab a lot of offensive boards that you wouldn't expect her to.
Yeah, and the Hillers have taken the lead again, up by 1 point.
And Morningstar a bit too aggressive there, committing the foul on against Leone. And Leone brings it up for Ashland. 7.5 minutes left, Hopkinson up one. Russell gets the ball off the screen. High arc off the glass, off the top of the glass. And she calmly knocks down that layup, giving Ashland the lead back.
Yeah, I would expect this game to go down to the wire. Both teams have been playing really well offensively.
Canestrari drives baseline, makes nice move, can't finish off the side of the backboard. And Miswosi grabs it for Ashland. Again, Leone with it, the main cog in, off, in Ashland's offensive scheme. Tried to get it down low to Mazurek. Gogolin with a nice play, able to knock it out of bounds. Still Clocker ball.
Yeah, Ivy Gogolin has been doing a better job on containing Mazurek. But Mazurek's such a defensive threat right now, and also on the offense.
Leone launches a three, air ball. Canestrari able to grab it. Morningstar ahead of everybody. Takes the foul, cannot knock it down, but she'll shoot two. Big play for Hopkinson.
Yeah, again, using that bread and butter. Anytime they see an open man on the open court, they're going to give it to her and they'll try and score.
Morningstar cannot knock down the first. And the second one knocks off the back of the rim and falls down, tying this game up at 37 apiece. Leone almost loses control of the ball there, able to recover. Trying to get it inside to Miswosi, knocked away, recovered by Canestrari. Pucci calling for it, baseline, hits Morningstar for three. Knocks it down, the freshman, Lily Morningstar. Probably, arguably, the biggest shot of her career thus far.
Yeah, and she's only a freshman, so Mr. Greco must be very pleased on how Morningstar has played this season, especially in this game.
And an offensive violation. Mazurek was parked down in the paint. Referees paying attention and a turnover.
Yeah, Mazurek has kind of cooled off this second half, so let's see how she does.
Canestrari thought about the three. Nice pass inside to Keaveney. Gogolin finding her open teammate down low, able to hit an open layup, making the biggest lead of the night for Hopkinton, up 42-37. Leone drives, gets rejected by Gogolin, and Gogolin comes up with the loose ball.
Yeah, she's really been playing a stout defense the second half.
Akashi almost loses it. Keaveney launches a three. Almost would have been huge for Hawkinson. Meanwhile, Leone has it. Pulls up for the deep two. and a timeout called. They gave her 3 points. I thought her toe was on the line. It looked like it from up here anyway.
Yeah, I thought so too. Her foot was definitely on the line, but
I think that's what the referees are discussing right now. We'll see what they plan to give her.
Yeah, I think they're still discussing right now.
Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in recognizing Ashland's Julia Leone, scoring her 1,000th. Sam Leone, scoring her 1,000th career goal.
Well, a big moment for Samantha Leone, the senior star of this Ashland team, scoring her 1,000th point.
Yeah, definitely. That's a huge accomplishment in any type of sport, scoring 1,000 points. We have a banner over here for the Hopkinton 1,000 Point Club. As you can see, there's less than 10 people who have ever done that in Hopkinton history, so definitely a big accomplishment for Leone, the senior.
And it's tough usually to score that many points because, like, we only have 4 years at high school. You're not always necessarily on varsity, which they don't keep track of the points for freshman or JV. So that means that she has been consistently good for the past 3 or 4 years for this Ashland team, which is quite the statement. And even now, today, playing one of her biggest games.
Of course, yeah, she's really shown up this game. And she has a lot to be proud about.
Canestari drives. Looks like it should have been an offensive foul on Canestari. Missouri took a big hit, nothing called.
Yeah, she's a really good defensive present for the Clockers.
Goglin comes up with a loose ball, now in the hands of Canestari. And Canestari again travels.
I'm not sure if I agree with that call, but maybe she must have misplanted one of her foot, and that's drew the travel.
She really should have just taken that layup running, instead tried to jump stop, let the defender go by her, and then she ended up taking an extra step and got hit with the travel. Hopkinton still up 42-40, 4 minutes left in the fourth quarter. Very close game, like you said, most likely going down to the wire. Mazurek launches the jumper, a bit short, she gets it right back, shoots it again, no good. Canestari launches the three, knocks it down, makes up for the travel. 45-40 lead for Hopkinton.
I think that was the biggest play in this game so far, getting Canestari the ball, shooting a very clutch three. Now the Hillers are up 5 points.
Leone wide open at the hoop, can't finish. Tough pass, Keaveney inside to Morningstar, who had Mazurek draped all over her, and then Mazurek is hit with the personal foul.
Yeah, Missouri has really cooled off the second half. She was such a defensive and offensive presence, but the second half has not been at her advantage. And she's going to take a seat.
Some substitutions for both teams. Callie Corby and Courtney Thurber returning to the game, while Morningstar shoots free throw. No good on the shot for Morningstar. Canestari with the heads up defensive play, able to almost take that away, knocks it out of bounds. Ashland retains possession. Thurber gets the ball taken away. Corby with it now. Tried to pass across court to Morningstar. Maswoswi there, able to steal it, and then with the great save. Meanwhile, Meg Russell down on the other end. Oh. Somehow that ball rolls in for her. The fast break layup for Russell.
Yeah, that was a very lucky shot that it went in for Russell. Now the Clockers are only down 3 points.
Morningstar with it, drives, makes a nice move. Able to put the floater in. Soft touch from the freshman.
Yeah, she's really come up big this game, especially in the second
right,
half.
Especially later, she's really turned it on. Leone drives to the hoop, delivers nice shot to Pucci, while Pucci takes the foul. Leone will shoot too, looking to add to that 1,000 points.
And Coach Greco really does not like that call.
Leone cannot knock down the first. Second one goes through, 47-43 in favor of Hopkinton. And surprisingly, Hopkinton has gone to Morningstar really to handle most of the ball handling duties here toward the end of the game, usually reserved for Emma LaCascia, but the freshman has really stepped up and has earned the trust of Coach Greco.
Yeah, definitely. She's had the hot hand for this second half, and I don't blame Coach Greco at all. Give the ball to the player that she had to ball.
And one, Michaela Pucci. Time running down on the shot clock. She's able to muscle her way through the paint and knock down the layup while getting fouled.
Great play by Michaela Pucci.
And she makes it a three-point play.
The Hillers starting to pull away, seven-point game.
Hillers have really turned it on in the latter part of the third quarter, and here in the fourth, not scoring much at all in the first half, but now have been able to get multiple successful trips in a row, establishing that seven-point lead. Flynn drives, throws up the layup off the rim, and grabbed by Welzel. And Coach Greco calls a timeout with 1:37 left. Again, Hopkinton up 50-43, their biggest lead here tonight, 7 points. And really, they had not had a lead until midway through the third quarter.
Yeah, they've definitely turned it on the second half. For the game plan for the Hillers, I would most likely try and focus on defense. They really don't have to score or don't need the necessity of scoring that much. As long as they can keep Ashland from not scoring, not giving up any easy plays, or not giving up some big three-pointers, they look like they're in good position to advance to the semifinals.
And again, I just wanted to say that the winner of this game will play the winner of a game tomorrow between Notre Dame and Marlboro, and that game will take place on March 9th at 7:30. So the Hillers have an opportunity here to advance. Last minute and a half, up seven. We'll see what Coach Greco told his team and how they respond here in the last minute and a half. Hopkinton will start with the ball.
The clock is still showing that 2-3 zone. They've been sticking with that for the majority of the game.
Canestrari open for three. Getting a piece of it was Leone. Pucci crashed the boards, cannot finish. Now Leone has it. She drives the whole way, gets blocked by Gogolin. A great play from the sophomore. She has been huge defensively here in the second half.
Absolutely.
Morningstar dribbles her way through the Ashland press and draws a foul. The two biggest players, I think, here in the second half for Hopkinton have been a sophomore in Ivy Gogolin and a freshman in Lily Morningstar.
Yeah, that just speaks volumes to how Coach Greco has compiled this team. And it only goes up from here. He has a lot more talent in the freshman class, but he has a lot of depth in this roster right now. They have a lot of sophomores on the bench warmers right now. So as he can probably train them up, get them ready for next season. So definitely the girls basketball will be a formidable force in the Tri-Valley in the coming years.
This year included. They're
definitely
pretty good this
year
too. As Morningstar knocks down both free throws, a 9-point lead for Hopkinton. Leone needs some help from her teammates right now. She's been carrying the load for most of this game. Has gone a little cold recently.
If I were the Clockers, I'd want to get Mazurek back into the game. It's only a minute remaining, and the Clockers are down 9.
And a 5-second violation call. Not what you need if you are Ashland. A turnover with a minute left.
They're showing the full court press right now.
Probably going to start fouling soon. Hopkinton now just throwing the ball around, trying to keep it moving. Too aggressive there was Kiara Flynn, trying to pry it away from Ivy Gogol, and she's hit with the reach-in. And now Hopkinton will be shooting too in the double bonus. She knocks down the first, a 10-point lead for Hopkinton. And she knocks down both clutch free throws from the sophomore. 45 seconds left for Ashland to mount a comeback, down 11. They need to be shooting quick. Don't have time to pass around, looking for a great shot. A turnover there, Kanashari grabs a loose ball. Ashland should be fouling. A loose ball results in a jump ball going to Ashland.
And the shot clock has been turned off, so Ashland, I think they have to shoot some threes right now. Down 11 points.
Leone with it, 20 seconds left. Down 11, not shooting. Surprising me, Russell finally gets a layup up and in, and coach calls a timeout. Ashland calls a timeout with 11 seconds left, down 9. Well, in anything short of a miracle, and Hopkinton should move on to the next round. Up 9 with 11 seconds left. I'm really surprised Ashland did not try to get a quicker shot. Instead, they settled for passing it around and getting a good opportunity, but wasting a lot of time in the process.
Absolutely. If I was in that situation, I would want to foul as quickly as possible, trying to get them miss a few free throws and then try and get the ball back, score quickly.
All right, that's really your only option. And Ashland just kind of let the ball be passed around.
And Captain Sarah Birchman has entered the game.
Coach
senior.
Greco getting his senior in there the last 10 seconds here. And a travel there from Birchman. Shuffled her feet right after she caught the pass. Eight and a half seconds left for Ashland.
Good
and
pass.
Miss Mosley hits the open layup, but that should do it here. Because the ball is passed in and Hopkinton takes the victory 54-47. In what was a great game here tonight at Hopkinton.
Absolutely. Both teams came out a little bit jittery, but then Hopkinton was able to gather themselves in the second half and really had a great defensive showing in the second half. Great win for the girls. But Ashland also, they played a great game, especially Leone and Mazurek. They had a great first half. And this, I think, is Leone's last game as a high schooler.
Yep,
so
she is a senior. She's done. She got her 1,000 points, and now she's out.
Definitely. Huge accomplishment to end your season like that.
Absolutely. So that does it here from this Division II MIAA tournament. Hopkinton takes the victory, 54-47. For Vinny Gotham, I am Tim Haladic. Thanks for watching, everybody.